Hello everyone. Thank you very much for your interest in this talk in which I will be presenting our latest work in the study of position-based cryptography from the perspective of Banach space theory. I would also like to thank the organizers for their work in this conference and for this opportunity to share my work. This is joint work with Marius Junge, Palazuelos and David Pérez-García. The talk will be structured in three main sections, starting with an introduction to position-based cryptography and the main open problems in this field. In the second part of the talk, I will introduce the object that we study in this work, which is a position verification protocol that we call GRAT. This protocol will be connected, the study of this protocol will be connected with some mathematical constructions, allowing us to obtain some new results, which will appear in the third part of the talk. In position-based cryptography, one aims to solve the following cryptographical problem. Suppose that two agents want to establish secure communication between themselves. Suppose further that one of the agents, the verifier, is suspicious about the identity of the other agent, the prover. The main idea in position-based cryptography to solve this problem is using the geographical position of the prover as the certificate for its identity. This makes position verification the main task in this cryptographical scenario. In the simplest one-dimensional case, two verifiers are located surrounding the verifying point in which the honest prover is located. The verifiers interact, sending messages to the prover, and the prover is expected to answer with some proof of its position. In order to accept the verification, the verifiers check whether a prover's answer arrives in the correct time to the verifiers. More concretely, if we consider that messages from the verifier to the prover take a time t in order to reach the prover, the answers from the prover must arrive at the verifiers at time 2t. If this condition is fulfilled, the verifiers further check the correctness of prover's answers. This setting turns out to be inherently insecure. The reason is the possibility of colluding attacks. In a colluding attack, a team of cheaters intercept the communication between the verifiers and the prover and try to simulate the action of a honest prover. When the protocol for the verification is purely classical, this kind of attacks can easily cheat any such proposal. This motivates the introduction of quantum protocols in which the communication between verifiers and prover is quantum. Now the goal of the honest prover is implementing some quantum operation on the systems received from the verifier. It was shown that colluding cheaters, in fact, are also able to successfully cheat in this scenario, but now they are required to use entanglement as a resource in order to achieve a high enough success probability. This makes, from the following question, the main open problem in the field. So we ask, in particular, what is the amount of entanglement that a team of cheaters require in order to break the security of any quantum position verification protocol? No results about this quantity display an exponential gap between lower and upper bounds. And trying to close this gap is the main motivation of the work that I presented today here. In order to make some progress toward this question, we consider an intermediate setting in which classical resources will be considered to be free. In the protocols that we analyze, one of the verifiers sent to the prover a quantum system, but the other verifier will send just a classical index, which determines what is the operation that is expected to be applied by the prover in the received system. We will study the scenario of colluding attacks also for this kind of protocols. And as I said before, the main simplification that we make here is considering classical resources as completely free. A remark in this setting is that generic attacks to position verification protocols also apply in this case, and the upper bound for the dimension of the resources used by cheaters in this case is exponential in the security parameter n, which indicates the dimension of the quantum system prepared by the verifiers. Our main goal in this work is providing new lower bounds for this quantity. For that, we relate the study of this dimension with the study of particular Banach spaces. With that, we are able to prove, in fact, the exponential lower bounds for what we called smooth cheating strategies. That is, for strategies that depends on the classical index x in a sufficiently regular way, this kind of exponential lower bound must be fulfilled if the strategy is successfully cheating the protocol. One motivation to study this kind of strategies is that known generic attacks to position verifications, in fact, fulfill this kind of smoothness conditions. However, we don't know whether this is a universal feature or whether there exist attacks that violate this condition. Moving to the study of general strategies, we also can obtain exponential lower bounds for the dimension of the resources employed by the cheaters, but this time conditioned on the validity of a conjecture that is related with some properties of Banach spaces. The status of this conjecture couldn't be solved in this work, but at least we were able to provide some evidence supporting a positive resolution of the conjecture. To finish this first section of the talk, I comment also on the recent concurrent work of Andreas Blum, Matthias Christandel, and Florian Spellman, in which the authors studied a similar setting to the one that is studied in our work. From a cryptographical point of view, the results that they obtain are much stronger than the results in our work, but we believe that the main contribution of the work I'm presenting today is are the techniques that we introduce in the study of this problem. And in fact, these techniques can be naturally extended to settings beyond the realm of, beyond the scope of this work. And in particular, some partial results can be also obtained in the original setting in which the quantum and classical resources are weighted on a similar basis. Now we move into the definition of the particular protocol that we are going to study in this work. In the protocol GRAT, the verifiers start preparing a quantum system and sending two n-dimensional registers to the prover. From the other side, the other verifier sample uniformly random signed vector of n squared coordinates and send it to the verifier, to the prover. Upon the reception of this information, the prover is expected to apply a unitary determined by the sine vector epsilon. The unitary to be applied is simply a diagonal unitary in which the coefficients are given by the signs of the chosen vector. The ideal outcome of prover's action is precisely the outcome of this computation. Once these answers arrive to the verifiers, they check the timeliness condition of the protocol and the correctness of these answers, measuring the final system with some projective measurement, which checks whether the unitary U sub epsilon was correctly implemented or not. Next, we start now the analysis of colluding attacks in this setting. So after the interception of the communication between verifiers and prover, and with some pre-shared entanglement that the cheaters can share, they apply some local operations, V and W to epsilon, and then are allowed to send simultaneously a message to the other partner. After receiving this message from the other attacker, the cheaters are still allowed to apply another local unitary, resulting in the outcome to be sent back to the verifiers. And essentially, this is the most general structure of the cheating action in this scenario. I remind you that in our setting, classical communication was considered to be a free resource. So apart from the picture above, cheaters are also allowed to send an unlimited amount of classical communication, always respecting the causal structure that is imposed by the timeliness condition of the protocol. Then the main parameter that we want to study is the dimension of the local system that the cheaters have to manipulate in order to successfully cheat in the protocol GRAT. This will be determined by the parameter K. So our main goal will be studying lower bounds actually for this parameter K in terms of the security parameter N. From the picture above, it's clear that cheating strategies for GRAT can be characterized by sequences indexed in epsilon of local operations and a quantum pre-shared state. With this characterization, it's now natural to try and associate to any strategy S a Boolean function taking values on some well-suited Banach space X. For a meaningful definition of this function phi, what we require is preserving some relation between the study of the protocol GRAT and the study of the properties of the function. In particular, we will define this map phi in such a way that the success probability attained by the cheating strategy S will be upper bounded by the average of the norm of the images by phi. Then we translate that way the study of cheating strategies for our position verification protocol into the study of properties of this map phi. In order to study this quantity, we first need to introduce two technical notions. The first one is the regularity notion for Boolean functions with values in a Banach space X. For such a function, we define a parameter sigma, which is essentially the norm of the average of the norm of the discrete gradient of our function phi. The subindex log in the equality stands simply because we are hiding a logarithmic term in front of this expression that is unimportant for our purposes in this work. To further motivate this notion, I consider now the case of linear maps. So in this context, a linear map is constructed as follows. Consider some elements x1, xn squared in the unit ball of our Banach space X. Then define the image of a epsilon, of a vector epsilon by our map phi as the signed sum of the element chosen before, where the signs in front of the x element are given by the point in which we're evaluating the function. For such a function, it's very easy to compute the discrete derivatives. And this gives us an upper bound for the regularity parameter sigma for this kind of maps. And it turns out that the order of this parameter is decreasing with a linear amount in N in the size of the Boolean cube here. This example is particularly important because actually linear maps in this context are the prototypical example of a smooth function in the sense discussed before. The other notion that we need to introduce is the one of type 2 constant of the Banach space X. This constant is the lowest real number that we can introduce in this inequality in order to make it true for any sequence of elements in the Banach space X. The related notion of type 2 constant with n vectors is essentially the same, but restricting the sequences of elements taken from our space to have cardinality at most n. Again, I motivate this notion with a simple example in which we consider a Hilbert space as our particular Banach space. In such a space, we can take just two vectors, x1, x2, and the parallelogram law implies the inequality in the right side of the slide. Moving around these two factors, we can reinterpret actually this parallelogram law as an expression similar to the one in the definition of type constants. And in fact, we can see that a consequence of the parallelogram law is that the inequality in the definition is fulfilled with an equality and with constant one. In particular, this implies that the type 2 constant of a Hilbert space is equal to one. This argument extends easily for any number of vectors in a Hilbert space. So in fact, the type 2 constant of a Hilbert space is always one. In this sense, type 2 constants are somehow a measure of how Banach space X geometrically differs from the behavior of a Hilbert space. With these two notions at hand, we come back to the goal of bounding the expected value of the expression here. For that, we recall an inequality that was discovered by PCA, which which combined with the two notions that I introduced before, allow us to easily obtain the following corollary, which is an upper bound precisely for the quantity in which we are interested. With all this, I will finish this section of the talk sketching the general structure of the argument that will allow us to obtain new lower bounds on the resources consumed by cheaters in our position verification protocol. In the first step, I remind that we have characterized cheating strategies as sequences of such elements. And this induces an association between strategies and Boolean functions with values in a Banach space X. Defining our function phi in a well-suited way, we are able to prove a lemma that relates the success probability of the cheaters with the expected value of the norm of images of this map. With PCA inequality, we can translate this upper bound into an upper bound, which is composed by these two terms. In general, we will find that the first term in the right-hand side is always upper bounded by some constant, which is really less than one. So we can just focus on the study of the second term. This second term depends first in the regularity parameter of our map sigma and on the type 2 constant of the image space X. Studying this latest space is how we can obtain some upper bounds for the cheating probability. Okay, so using this argument, we can obtain the following results. So the main idea is defining in a proper way the function that we assign to any strategy S. So starting with a strategy S, we first give the following definition for this map. For that definition, what we have done is focusing on the elements of the strategy that defines the second round of local operations applied by the cheaters in the action. Choosing the space of bounded operators on a k-squared dimensional Hilbert space as the image space of phi, we can obtain the lemma relating the success probability of the cheaters and the properties of our function phi. As I said before, we can in fact obtain an upper bound for the first term in PGS inequality, which is strictly lower than one. And additionally, in this case, we can also obtain an upper bound for the type 2 constant of the Banach space involved. And it turns out that this type 2 constant is logarithmic in the dimension. Gluing all these pieces together, we can obtain the following theorem, which is just an upper bound on the success probability that a cheating strategy S attains in GBAT. A corollary of this theorem is that any cheating strategy attaining a value close to one, a success probability close to one, and fulfilling some smoothness condition, which is related with how strongly the second part of cheater's action depends on the classical input epsilon. So if we impose such a smoothness condition, then we can prove exponential lower bounds for the quantum dimension K. We can modify the definition of our function phi in order to study now functions with strategies which are smooth in the first part of the strategy. This complicates, from a technical point of view, the study of our function phi, but similar results can be obtained with, again, an exponential lower bound in K, conditioned on some smoothness condition, which now is related with the dependence of the first round of local operations applied by the cheaters with the classical parameter epsilon. Finally, I also comment on the possibility of redefining once more the function phi in order to study general strategies, which doesn't fulfill any continuity assumption. This complicates even more the Banach space that appears as an image in our function. But choosing this Banach space properly, we still can have a lemma relating the success probability attained by the strategy S and this expected value of the expression of our map. An important feature of this map that we have defined before is that it is linear by construction in the sense of the example that I showed before. This implies that, in fact, by construction, this map is smooth. And in fact, it's not only smooth, it's also symmetric under interchanging the sign of the vector epsilon, which allow us to conclude an upper bound for the success probability attained by the cheaters using strategy S in terms of the type 2 constant of this Banach space tilde X. As I said, this Banach space is quite convoluted, and we were not able to determine their properties from their type and co-type properties. The best that we could do is obtaining some evidence supporting the conjecture that the type two constant of such a map or such a space is small enough. So if this conjecture is fulfilled, then we would obtain a corollary as the previous ones, but without any assumption on the properties, on the analytical properties of the strategies. The status of this conjecture is left as an open question for now. And to finish this presentation, I will also comment on some future directions that seems like quite promising for this work. First, I will comment on the possibility of modifying the protocol GRAT in order to reduce the size of the protocol, already taking into account in the same basis classical and quantum resources. So now in our modified protocol, we fix a sine vector epsilon and then distribute to the prover an n-dimensional system from each verifier. Again, the goal of the verifier is implementing our unitaries U sub epsilon and forwarding the outcome of this computation to the provers. In this setting, the techniques that we construct before can be also applied, and some partial results in similarity to the one presented before can be also obtained. Apart from that, other interesting future directions for this work are, first of all, the study of the regularity parameters sigma, in particular, the relation of this parameter with some physical properties of the cheating strategies. It would be also very interesting to find some methods allow us to regularize strategies that in principle are non-smooth. Another interesting direction is further exploring the purely mathematical problems that we tackled in this work, which are related with the estimates of type constant for some Banach spaces and with properties of tensor norms with respect to these kind of notions. A final comment, and more speculative, is also about the recent connection that was discovered between the study of position-based cryptography and the boundary description of some processes in the context of ADS-CFT duality. In particular, we might ask whether the techniques that we introduce in this work may have some implications in this context. And that's all. Thank you very much for your attention. And I'm looking forward to meet you at the live session at TQC.